Good evening, friends. I'm so glad to see everyone here. You know, an astronomer is recognizable by his telescope. He always has one somewhere. An archaeologist you thought was recognizable by a bullwhip, but not really. It's by a half-meter photographic scale. I'm going to show you how we use it here shortly. I'm going to talk about the rise and fall of the Mayan civilization, a topic I used to cover in a semester-long class. Can I do it in 40 minutes or less? You betcha. Sure. The Mayas still exist. This was a gentleman who was one of the tour guides for a Viking excursion when we were on the island of Cozumel just a year or two ago. And he was a happy, beaming, smiling man who allowed me to take his photograph. And my gosh, the proportions of his eyes, his nose, his hair, his quality. He was Maya, through and through. And I contrapposed him there with a drawing of a Maya from the classical period. So sometimes people say, well, what happened to the Maya? They're still there. There are still millions of them in Guatemala and Honduras and in Mexico. In some of these countries, they are treated better than others. In fact, at one point in my college career, I had over 24 students from Central America studying Mayan archaeology with me, and it turned out half of them were Mayan, but they denied it to the other students because of the prejudices sometimes against those who are part of the indigenous community. So if you go on the provided excursion, you get to go visit an archaeological site called San Gervasio. And St. Gervasius was an early Christian martyr. His parents were killed, his brother was killed, and then he said, come on, what about me? And so they killed him too. During the second century AD, he was from the city of Milan, Italy. And my guess is the site got the name of St. Gervasio because the Spanish explorer who landed on the island of Cozumel probably landed on, guess what, the 18th of June. And since that's the feast day of St. Gervasio, then St. Gervasio was the name given to the island and to the archaeological site in the center of it. But the name didn't stick to the island. The island of Cozumel still retains its actual Native American name. In the Mayan language, Cozumel is composed of Cozan, tree swallow, a bird, and then Lumle, which is the word for land. So we're going to be docking on the island of the tree swallows. Isn't that a kind of a cute thought? That was known that way all the way back in antiquity. Mayan have been living on that island from at least approximately 100 years before Christ, all the way up to the time of Spanish contact, 1550. And actually, they are still there on the island. Now, the archaeological site, and you know, I'm kind of destination related. The archaeological site some of you will go see is this one right here, San Gervasio. And you get a lot of things to look at when you're there, and you don't have a lot of time. The biggest temple is this temple here, which is, the footprint of it's a little bigger than the stage platform, and it's approximately about 40 feet tall. And no, they won't let you climb on it. There's very few pyramids they let tourists climb on because of two reasons. One, they fall off and hurt themselves. And two, my wife's laughing. The second reason is that climbing on these things caused them to deteriorate. They were never built to last this long with lots of people climbing up and down on them. This was the temple for the worship of a goddess named Ixchel. And she was a goddess of fertility and of childbirth. And we actually know something about her thanks to an artifact in the Boston Museum of Fine Arts. Anybody here from Boston? Well, this one's on display. It's a beautiful piece, a rare piece. It is a container that had been buried with an elite Mayan king. It would originally have contained chocolate, something they enjoyed in life and enjoyed in the afterlife. And if you can see up here in the upper band, the glyph band up there, up there. See that? That is the hieroglyphic Suja. And it looks like a kind of angry iguana. And that was, believe it or not, the hieroglyphic for birth. And this was a pottery vessel describing the birth of a highly important person and that moment in their life. And here's the rollout. This is a special photographic technique that archaeologists have developed. So when we've got a pot that's been painted 360 all the way around, we can roll out a photograph of it. You put it on a tripod and have it rotate very constant rate to get this rollout picture. Here is the goddess Exhel on the left-hand side, and she is literally squatting and has given birth to a rabbit. And you can actually see the umbilical cord from between her legs coming up to the rabbit. And the rabbit's got several little hieroglyphic cartoon comment here, like, I'm happy to be born. Boy, good deal. And what's interesting in this panel, as we can translate about half the hieroglyphics. We still don't have this full thing solved. We can read about half the hieroglyphics. It's celebrating the birth of a ruler who then decided to show the scene of the goddess, whose name is translated as Red Lady, giving birth to a rabbit. And then she hands the rabbit to another goddess. And this goddess right here is called White Lady. And White Lady's cleaned up the newly born rabbit, which is pretty large, isn't it? And another goddess is going to nurse it. Bizarre, isn't it? Now, to the Maya, when they saw the full moon, they didn't see a man in the moon. Chris will tell you there's a man in the moon. That's the astronomy Americans have. To the Maya, there was a rabbit in the moon. And so what's interesting, on the island of Cozumel, the site that we visit, is a site where the goddess who gives birth to the rabbit is worshipped, and this rabbit is associated with the moon. So if your guide tells you that Cozumel and that archaeological site relate to the worship of moon, it's partially right. It's actually a worship of the fertility of women, their success at birthing, and the fact that they saw and understood a correlation between the phases of the moon and phases of women's fertility. Now, on this cruise ship, that's not going to happen. The phases of the moon are not going to coincide with fertility of you. But when you live in an environment that's pre-modern, without electric lights, without caffeine soda, without all the things that mess with cycles of life, women's fertility cycles and moon cycles will begin to coincide. You got to have a biologist tell you why that happens. But I'll tell you, as an anthropologist, it's true. And so it was interesting that they saw the magical connection between this island, women's birthing children, and the birth of this rabbit that signified in some ways the moon. So when you're at San Gervasio, one of the places they'll take you is this building with a thatched roof on it. That's not the original thatched roof. They put that on there, which I'm happy for because it helps protect the ruins. And this building was the headquarters and shrine for a military general who had conquered the island probably about 800 years ago. And when you go there, they will point out some red handprints on the wall. And most guides will tell you, we don't know what it means. Or maybe it was a happy birthday party decoration. Now, I'm going to tell you what I think it means. May not be the truth, but at least what I believe. I believe those handprints represent a revolt of the people on the island against the military overlord who had conquered them. And the handprints are on there to say what? We killed them. We took away their lives. Now, the handprints are, this is a plan of that temple. The handprints are on these walls all through here. And then in the center of that building, there was a shrine to the god of Chichen Itza. Not to the Red Lady, not to the White Lady, but to the god of Chichen Itza. And that shrine probably looked about like this, when it was originally operational. This is a modern Day of the Dead shrine that I photographed on Cozumel, where there is an offering being made. The cross on the ground, obviously, to Jesus, right? But this type of shrine was to the souls of your departed dead, as well as to your God who saves you. Right outside of that headquarters building is an altar where the God of Chichen Itza would receive sacrifices. That God of Chichen Itza is the plumed serpent, the God Kukulkan. And oh, by the way, there's my scale. See the scale? What did I tell you, right? Part of my equipment package. So when we're photographing stuff, we can see how big that head was. There's the serpent's head. There is a road system at the archaeological site of San Gervasio. And when you say this is kind of a crummy road, it's not very wide, it's not very level. It wasn't a road for commercial use. It was a road for religious parades and rituals and bringing of sacrifices to that altar. And what kind of sacrifices were they making on that altar? Not far away is a building called the ossuary, the bone house. And in it, when excavated, the archaeologists found human bones. Were they the bones of the governor who governed the place? I don't think so. They were bones of individuals who had been brought and sacrificed there. And I've actually thrown in a couple little fragments of, not Aztec, these are Mayas, representations of skulls that would be stacked up inside of a structure like that to represent to the god Kukulkan what had been given to him, those lives that had been sacrificed. Now, in my lecture today, I have to say thanks to Professor David Friedel at Washington University in St. Louis, who is the excavator and current project director of a dig of a site in Guatemala called El Peru. Its ancient name was Huaca. And he's given me permission to use a couple of his unpublished images today. I also have to have a sad memory of Professor Marshall Durbin at Washington University, who literally died within a month or so after I arrived to study with the man. He was a Mayan epigrapher. He was a Mayan translator of these languages. He passed away, and I said, "Are you going to hire another one?" And they said, "No, we're not. We're reassigning you, young man. You're not going to be a Mayan archaeologist." But that's okay. I still get to talk to you about it and dream about it. This wonderful artifact was found by David Friedel. It is one of the unpublished images he's letting me show you. It's a statue about that tall of a queen, but she has taken her husband's shield on her arm because he has died, and she is honoring him. The civilization of the Maya was as rich in many ways as that of the ancient Greeks and the Romans, and we're only beginning to now tease out the stories as we're able to read some of the hieroglyphic material. Now, the Maya occupied the Yucatan Peninsula and the highlands of Guatemala. And in those environments, different cities grew up because cities discovered there were unique resources that could be extracted from their area that were unavailable to other portions of the Mayan people. So we're going up here to Cozumel, and you see all those little black triangles? That represents the fact that in that area, there were natural deposits of stone that contained the precious gem jade. How many of you have a piece of jade jewelry, ladies? Jade's cool stuff, yeah. To the Maya, jade was something that the gods loved. They desired it more than gold. Isn't that interesting? Jade was a more valuable material. So jade coming from the area of Cozumel would be exchanged for honey, for cotton, for cocoa beans, for a variety of other materials that showed up all throughout the area of the Mayan civilization. And in fact, in all of those unique resource areas, cities would grow, first from villages to towns to cities, and complex lines. It looks like a subway map, doesn't it, of London? But it's not. It's all of the Mayan cities we know so far. And we find more in the jungles as we continue to research. And we use LIDAR now to find them in the jungles where there's very deep vegetation. Look how many of these are all scattered around. And some are allies and some would become enemies. In particular, there were six cities in the center of the Yucatan Peninsula that were constantly struggling to have dominance over the others. Because if you control the core of the Mayan homeland, then you could easily begin to control the periphery, the hinterland. And literally in the physical core of it all was a city today that is in Guatemala called Tikal. And there were north of it a city called Calakmul. And they would be locked in a death struggle for centuries to determine who would be the ultimate ruler of the core of the Mayan world, which means they would then control all of the hinterland areas also. This was what the ancient city of Tikal looked like, we believe, if you could step back in a time machine roughly 1,500 years ago. It's been intensely studied by the University of Pennsylvania that still continues to carry out archaeological projects there. Massive pyramids, beautifully stuccoed and painted, a city of great staggering size, and a city that has history going back as far as 2000 BC, and then coming all the way up through these different layers of history till we reach what's called late post-classic. And those divisions of time, they're not really arbitrary. They are pretty much based on what we have been able to reconstruct from both radiocarbon dates and from their own inscriptions as to how things were growing and changing and what was happening within the city during these time periods. Now, you can't talk about the origin of Mayan civilization without reflecting on their own story of their origin. We have seen a book that was written about the creation of the Maya world. Its name is the Popol Vuh. It had originally been written in hieroglyphics, and then because it was deteriorating, a Mayan man transcribed it into Spanish. And it was seen by a historian over a century ago, shown this book. He copied down what he read, and that man closed it up, and it's never been seen again. It's kept among the Maya. According to the Popol Vuh, there were originally two gods who were called the Hero Twins. And they realized that the sun could not rise unless they killed a false god. They called him the False Sun. And they kill him as well as his wife, which allows the true sun to rise. I think that is an interesting alliteration to the fact that at the end of what's called the pre-classic period, Mayans put down and eliminate what had been a earlier civilization called the Olmec. And they, in that process though, in fact, in the Popol Vuh, it said they took his gems, they took his soul, and then they made their new world. They took writing from Olmec. They took some aspects of architecture and art from Olmec, but they made something grander, more gorgeous, and more beautiful. It's interesting that according to the Popol Vuh, grandmother grinds white corn and yellow corn. She mixes her own tears into the cornmeal, and she makes the first men and the first women. And she makes four of them. And you know what's interesting? That each city could try to claim that they had been one of the originals made by grandmother. And how far back does this refer to? Probably things historically happening around 2000 to 1000 BC. That's what Mayan corn looks like today, still grown. And that's what the grinding pedestal looks like with the handheld large stone, the mano, and then this heavy stone, the matate, that's being used to grind the corn into meal to make it flour. These are what the Hero Twins killed. These are the elder brothers, and they're very interesting. These two are sort of monkey scribe twins. They were found again by my colleague digging at this site in Guatemala. When things like that are found, by the way, they go to the Guatemala National Museum. For many generations, things would be found and they would be taken out of these countries to American museums, to American universities. And in fact, I've actually seen the head archaeologist from Guatemala visiting the St. Louis Art Museum, and I watched the man cry to see what we had there that had been taken from his country that was better than what he had on display in his own museums. So it's interesting that our ability to tell the story of the Maya was changed by the work of one American professor at the University of Texas in Austin. Her name is Linda Shealy. And Linda Shealy made groundbreaking revelations about Mayan history by being able to crack the Mayan code. She did not do it by herself. There were Russian archaeologists and epigraphers. There were French and many, many different nationalities worked together, but she alone probably did the most critical intellectual labor that gives us now the ability to read not all, but a significant amount of the hieroglyphic inscriptions. She was able to say, these guys are not a bunch of hippies. They are warriors. They are great kings, and we actually can read the names of their kings. So it's really interesting. When we read the inscriptions at the archaeological site of Tikal, its name is written everywhere on inscriptions, on temples, on monuments, on altars, but it doesn't say the place is called Tikal. It says its name was Mutul. And what apparently happened was after it fell, after it collapsed, after it was conquered, it became taboo, forbidden to mention its original name, Mutul. And so it was only known as Tikal, the death, the dead city that had once been the thriving city of Mutul. This is a plan pre-LIDAR. This is a plan old-fashioned, old-school archaeology, going through the jungle with machetes and transits and tapes, of mapping out the patterns of temples, of sacred causeways, and then of all the small houses and other compounds and scattered deep within the forest, all around the city today we call Tikal. They called it Mutal. And a huge question had often been, why did they need so many pyramids? Was each pyramid to a different god? We now realize that almost every pyramid in the main complex of Tikal was a tomb, and it contained the burial of one of their leaders who was embedded within the structure. And oftentimes his wife and many times sacrificial victims also placed there. And so when you inherit from your father the right to rule in a place called Tikal, you know you must build your own monument. And the bigger your ego, the what? The bigger the pyramid. We've been able to reconstruct a series of back and forth wars between the city of Tikal and the city of Calakmul. Starting in AD 90, there's the great shark, what a name, eh? Who takes power. Do you remember in my lecture yesterday, I showed you a statue that had a shark as an emblem on it? That's an Olmec emblem. The great shark, he would be defeated, his descendants would be defeated by Snake King from Calakmul. But just a few years later, 15 years later, a rebel dynasty with reinforcements from central Mexico, from Teotihuacan, will reconquer and retake the city. Snake King from Calakmul usurps again in 359. AD 456, Stormy Sky dies but is able to restore the city to its original power. And then AD 561, again, a king of Calakmul, whose name is Sky Witness, will conquer and usurp the throne. In fact, at Tikal, we get these wonderful monuments that show the faces of their kings and queens. And the inscriptions on the back of them in hieroglyphics will tell us either that it is to celebrate the birth of this ruler, the crowning of this ruler as king, the victory on a battlefield, or their death. These will oftentimes all be signified by a stele. And we'll note that their bodies are buried in what is called a wheats. A wheats was the mountain of creation, but it's actually the man-made pyramid that was created to take the body of their rulers. In excavations like those carried out by University of Pennsylvania, they have actually found the tombs of some of these kings. Here, a king named Yaxnun Ahin, which name translates as nose with a curl in it, curly snout, which probably he didn't have a curled nose, but it meant something happened at the time of his birth that his mother and father chose to give him that name, curled nose. And he was buried with wonderful artifacts placed in the tomb with him, elaborately decorated pottery vessels, several of those filled with that chocolate I told you that was so desired, and significant amounts of jade. Because as I told you, jade was what they desired as people to have, and they knew the gods desired jade. In fact, why would you have a lot of jade buried in your tomb? Because in the next life, you could trade it to the gods of the underworld for better conditions. Here's a piece of jade that came out of that grave, and this is about the size of the palm of your hand. And the gods of the Maya, they loved jade, they loved incense, and they loved human sacrifice. So this is the burial, how the man was laid out in his tomb, and then these are all the various materials placed in there with him. And guess who are the best archaeologists to do that kind of excavation? Big old lumbering guys like me? No, we oftentimes have the most petite young women and petite young men, because these tombs are not very large, and you don't need to have big feet. And in fact, they will all be down in that tomb in their socks, because the last thing you want is somebody stepping on one of these artifacts and breaking them. So you can imagine, by the way, when my wife and I were doing archaeological digs, Roman tombs, guess who got in and worked on the tomb? She did. And guess who sat right outside recording, writing, drawing, and packaging all the artifacts as she would uncover them. So David Friedel has given me permission to show you something he found that I think is so amazing. He excavated a king's tomb at the site of Waka. And in the tomb, there had been a miniature tableau of small figurines made intentionally to be buried with him. These figurines laid out here as he found them, but once they've been cleaned, are quite fascinating. At that point right over there is the figurine of a spirit being who is breathing and performing a magical ritual to give new life to the dead king. All of these figures around are individuals who had been in the court of that king. These are literally statues, miniature statuettes that reflect those individuals who had once lived, who could then be in the next life, a little bit like Egyptian beliefs. In the next life, they would accompany their king. And in the very center, that circle there, those contain the priest, the magicians, the shaman, the powerful ones who were able by their power to help bring this new world into existence. So here the king kneels. He's down to nothing but his loincloth, but he does have a couple of pieces of nice jade still on. His arms crossed as a magical deer performs the ritual to reincarnate him. And here's the shape-shifting deer dwarf shaman who must have been the director of the entire ritual of his burial. Cool stuff, eh? So in cities like Tikal, we have a famous king named Kawal Clears the Sky, who had a huge temple. And yes, most of these, they will not let you climb up. Because why? You're going to fall down and hurt yourself, or you're going to hurt the temple climbing up. In fact, one of the last large temples built in Tikal was by his son, whose name was Kawal Darkens the Sky. And what's Kawal? Kawal is the clawed hand of an eagle, right? Darkens the sky. And his father had been the dark, the hand of the eagle that clears the sky. So, before Linda Shealy figured out how to read this stuff, we could read the dates. We figured that one out a long time ago. But it was figuring out the verbs and figuring out the nouns and the pronouns that was so critical. Here's a series of inscriptions from the side of Calakmul, who says that on the 8th December 673, Shield Skull of Tikal attacked Dos Pilos. On the 23rd of May 673, Waka burned by Shield Skull of Tikal. And then 30th April 679, Shield Skull of Tikal defeated by Calakmul, who left blood pooled in its streets and skulls piled high. So, one of the things that Caroline alluded to was there was a rapid ascent of Mayan culture, of city building, of inscriptions, of temples. And then there was a rapid decline, which sometimes has been characterized as a collapse. But it didn't occur in 1 year. It started around AD 790 and extended all the way to 909. This is a graph of monuments with dates. And you can see there was a high point in 790. They were making more monuments with dates than they had at any other time. And then rapidly things began to fall apart. What was the cause of that? Some archaeologists have argued that repeated earthquakes damaged the buildings, frightened the people, and caused widespread abandonment of many cities. Others have suggested that drought dried up the landscape and the ability to grow corn that was so critical to them dissipated, and so did populations. Others have said that by environmental degradation, that by stripping the land of all of its trees for wood, for overutilizing fish resources and other resources, again, hunger had brought people down. And then there was it's a theory that political chaos is what caused the collapse. This, by the way, is the face of a very famous king. His name was 18 Rabbit. Remember Rabbit? 18 Rabbit, the king of Copan, reigned from 695 to 738. He died on a battlefield. And the enemy removed his head and took it away to celebrate. And his people brought his decapitated body back and buried it and noted that in the inscription. And indeed, the discovery of his body confirmed that was what had been his political end. The most recent dated inscription in all the Mayan world is from a site called Xibanche. And this is my photograph. You can see my scale, right? Against there to give you a scale for how large it is. It's not a very big inscription. And it shows the king on one side, that's the left, and then along the edge on the right, we have the hieroglyphic inscription, which tells us almost nothing. It doesn't say the world's falling apart. This is the last inscription anyone's ever going to read. What it says is, I got made the king in AD 909. Hooray for me, right? It's a celebration of kingship. But he was the last king to celebrate by making that inscription. Now, do you see the line across the left-hand side? That is where someone took a chainsaw and they were cutting it. And then they cut it on the other edge because they were going to smuggle it out of Guatemala and take it to the United States and sell it in pieces. But luckily, the police stopped it and it's now protected at the site. So here's what's really fascinating to me. When we look at the collapse, it didn't all occur in 1 year. And it did not occur simultaneously in the Mayan world. There's the first phase of collapse that took out Calakmul. Wonder who could have done that, right? Maybe Tikal. And then there's a second phase of collapse that takes out Karakol and Copan. And then finally, the last phase of the collapse, Tikal falls, Uxmal falls, and then a little later, but not much more, Chichen Itza collapses. Do you know what? I have a hard time if it's an earthquake, right? Earthquake ought to take everybody out. If it's drought, I have a hard time. Drought ought to take out lots of this area simultaneously. Environmental degradation and political chaos. Well, you know what's interesting is some Mayan cities did not collapse. They survived through the, quote, collapse. Cities like Mayapan, Tulum, Lamanai, Cebal. Why? They should have had the same set of problems, but they didn't. Here's what those four sites look like, and I'll tell you what has struck me is a couple of things. First of all, every one of these sites had something the big cities didn't have. Forgive me, but they had a wall. They had built walls around themselves, defensive walls. The big cities like Calakmul and Tikal, they were so arrogant, they did not need a wall. And do you know what happens when you don't have a wall around your city? People come in the middle of the night and take you out, take you down. These smaller sites had defensive walls. Interesting thought, isn't it? Secondly, they were all small. They were not juicy pickings if people were going to come to war against anybody. And it may have been their small size. And then I'm going to suggest something else. It may have been gifted political leaders in these four places who were able to keep a chaotic revolt from taking them out. In fact, at Mayapan, it's really interesting. They use some of the same hieroglyphic inscriptions like Chichen Itza did. The Venus glyph shows up all over the place. At Mayapan, they built an astronomical observatory, just a miniature but still functional version of what the city of Chichen Itza had built. And they also worshiped that god, the feathered serpent. But they did it in a more condensed, smaller scale. They have more affordable scale. Now, all right, degree in economics, anybody? An American archaeologist and an economist got together and they looked at the question of how big could Mayan cities have grown in terms of the resources around them. And look at the graphs. The graphs show you the little dots and then it drops and the little dots and it drops. The Mayan cities, they still had significant untapped resources around them. Do you know what I'm saying? Their ability to grow should have allowed even larger cities and bigger populations. But suddenly it just drops for cities like Tikal and for Calakmul. Now, John Eric Thompson, the leading British archaeologist for the Maya, he had suffered from post-traumatic stress disorder during World War I. And as he studied the Maya, he could not bring himself to see them as warlike or bloodthirsty. Because guess what? He didn't want them to be like modern 20th century countries. He studied the Maya. There he is living amongst them, the Lacandones in the area near Bonampak. He wrote about what gentle and cheerful people they were. But you know what? He like mistranslated stuff, either intentionally or accidentally. In fact, one of the most amazing things he did was this inscription right here. He translated Copan Altar Q as a conference of astronomers. Chris, they're swapping telescopes there, okay? And no. When Linda Sheely's able to read it, this is political propaganda, pure and simple. The man on the left is a conquering king who is literally taking the right of power, of rulership, from the ancestor of the last dynasty that he had put to death. Now, I gotta tell you, it's really interesting. If you tell on me, one of my old professors is gonna show up and wash my mouth out with soap. Because she was a student of this guy, Julian Stewart, and she said, conflict is never the explanation, it's always ecology. But let me tell you why Julian Stewart said that. Do you know what happened in the 1930s, 1940s, 1950s? If you talked about conflict caused by peasant uprisings, that sounded like Karl Marx, and you might be a communist. Oh, I'm no communist, let me tell you that. I'm a fat capitalist. But I actually think the idea of conflict theory explaining what's going on. For example, at many of the inscriptions at Tikal, they've been intentionally defaced and things have been erased. And I think that political chaos resulting from political leaders who, instead of solving problems, had more human sacrifice and declare another war. Oh my God, does that sound like what we're up to these days sometimes? Caused a lot of the low people, like the Lacandones, who are growing the food and supporting these rich cats, to rise up and take out a political hierarchy. So there are cities like Chichen Itza. It's abandoned, 1050. But other cities still continue all the way up to the time of the conquest by the Spaniards. The city of Mayapan still flourished. So when you see those handprints, I know the guide may have a different explanation. Do not correct the guide. Just know in your heart there's a crazy archaeologist on this ship who thinks those handprints represent the death of a group who had taken their island away from them. You know what I see it as is like the French Revolution. And by the way, did decapitating the French king and queen, did that end French civilization? No. It just changed. It just pivoted it, didn't it? And there's still people speaking French, and they're still making lovely food, and they still understand their history, but they also understand how there was a moment when it changed. So I will have, before we arrive in our final port of destination, Fort Lauderdale, I will have a lecture on untold stories of ancient Florida. That is not a Mayan artifact. That's a Florida artifact. And I'll tell you its secrets when you come then. Thank you for coming tonight. Oh!